This topology is pre-configured. As a unicast routing protocol, we are using AICRP 100. This is how the console of R1, R2, and R3. Multicast source and finally multicast destination. Fine. It's having some pay configuration, so I'm removing that. Fine. Now you see, we are having only show IP PIM interfaces. See, sparse mode is enabled. Version 2 is sparse mode. S means sparse mode. Show IP PIM neighbor, it's having neighborship with both of them. Show IP PIM RP mapping, does it have any RPS information? No. Show IP access list? No. Move on R3 now. Show IP access list? No. Do show IP PIM RP mapping. Does it have anything? No. Do one thing now, IP PIM RP address, because I'm going to use this R3's loopback. I'll configure this R3 as a RP itself for all devices, for all groups right now, right? So we can move on R3 now, and we can say IP PIM RP address is what this is. That how you will configure your static RP on all devices now, right? So move on all devices and configure the same command IP PIM RP address, then move on to R2, then finally move on R4. So now all devices are having this information that who is RP and how to reach it, because unicast routing protocol is always there. Show IP route, you can say onto R1, and you can see that how to reach 3333. So it is reachable via 12.1.2. However, you can see that R1 should have performed equal cost load balancing for the loopback of R3, but it is not performing because I have made some modification into their bandwidth and delay, so that for R1 its best path is now via R2 to reach its RP. In same manner, if you move on to R2, then also you can check its unicast routing table. You will find 333, R3's loopback, and you can try to ping with that as well. That is why I'm saying that RP, see, there is a rule that in sparse mode RP must be reachable from all devices, and RP must be configured on to all devices. So right now RP address is configured on to all devices, and also it is reachable from all. Now from R1 also you can try to communicate with 3333. Even you can press route it, you can see that it is going via R2, and then finally R3. You understand? So basically we have done all these things over here. We can move on to multicast source. However, I will not require to do anything on to multicast source right now, because I'm not going to generate any stream right now. And then I'll move on to multicast destination, and then once again I will go there onto its LAN interface, because it have joined some groups over here onto multicast destination. So what will I do? I'll move on this interface, and then I will remove these groups from here, so that there will not be any group member available at all, right? So right now we do not have anything. And one more thing that I would like to do now, clear IP M route and then star, and then I can configure this command onto all devices so that their M route table will get refreshed. And then see show IPP RP mapping. Previously it was not showing you anything, but this time you can see that for all groups its RP address is what? 3333. Fine. Good. Then after it you can move on to RP, which is R3 this time. See guys, show IP PIM interfaces. So PIM is enabled onto its loopback where 33 is configured, and that apart from that it is also enabled onto its WAN interfaces. Then after it you can see on R3 like show IP mroute, that does it have anything in its mroute table? Not yet. It does not have anything over here. It does not have anything over here right now. In previous class I explained you that how this sparse mode really works, right? So what will I do? Let's say that there is a group member, which is this multicast destination. It wants to join a group like 230.1.10. So what will I do? I will join this group over there, right? I'll join this group now onto multicast destination. So I'll move there onto its interface. I'll say IP ICMP join group 230.1.10. Now it will send a report message to its upstream router. Upstream router, because I'm using this router as a end station host. So it will generate a report message. R4 will receive it. Show IP mroute. You can check its mroute table. *GNP should be there. And now it will forward this join message towards RP. Who is RP? R3. Show IP mroute. You will also get that *GNP over here as well. But this time there is no RPF neighbor, because this RP rendezvous point does not have any information about that group. But it will create that *G entry, and then outgoing interface will be configured in its under outgoing interface list and in forwarding step. So whenever in future this R3 will start to receive any multicast system for this group address, then it will immediately start to send it towards R4. That is why we can move on to multicast source now, and we can say ping 230. Fine, 230.1.10. Now it must start to get replies from there, you see. And first packet will always go via RP, and then subsequent packets will be, will follow your SPT, so test path tree. I have already explained it to you in previous class, right? Now, there is a small problem. Right now, anyone can register itself onto RP. Right now, anyone can register itself onto RP. So this is the problem, because if anyone can become source, it means anyone can generate any multicast stream. Means that attacker can also generate a multicast stream. Are you getting my point or not? Right now anyone can generate a stream, anyone can become source, anyone can register itself onto RP. Anyone. Because there is no security at the end of RP, rendezvous point. But you can do that onto RP by using extended ACL, access list 101, permit IP, one source is host 181.68.1.10. I think it's 1.2. I'm permitting it, right? And when group is what? 230.1.10. .net. Fine. I have permitted only this group and this source, this *G entry, right? And then I will say IP PIM accept register and then list, and then your ACL number was, and see only extended ACL is allowed, because in standard ACL you will not be able to specify your source. You can specify only group addresses in standard ACL, but in extended you can specify your source as well as group address, for which you will accept now register messages. So now this RP will receive register messages, or will accept register messages coming from source 1.2 only for group 230.1.10. Even if the same source is generating, is sending register messages for any different group, then it will show you that okay, it received invalid register messages. So list 101, fine. And then after, what will I do after configuring this command? See what I did in ACL. I permitted this source 1.2 and only for this group address especially. and then you have applied it by using this command, and then after you do one thing, move back again on source, and this time generate multicast system for a different group, which is like 100. Same source will be there, but see what is it saying. Received register from this for this group not willing to be RP. So it received register, but it will never send register stop back to the sender. You see, show IPM route. Does it have any star, I mean a comma G entry for that group? .100 230.1.100. Is there any entry? Once you will remove this command from here, or you can modify your ACL as well, then you will see that it will accept this register this time. Debug IP PIM show IPM route. Let it receive, yes, not yet. Let it receive register messages first, and then I'll show you that. Okay, it will create S comma G entry in its mroute table. Yes, it have received. Oh, not yet. Actually, it didn't specify this group address actually over here. Group was all. You do one thing, stop it once, go to R1, fine, and once again I'll move on source and will start to send this multicast stream, and this time on to R3. See, for group 230.1.100 to IP, this time you must get that entry. Right now no one is receiving this multicast stream, that is why there is no interface under OIL, outgoing interface list. I hope that you can protect your RPs from unwanted sources, from unknown sources, right? So in this way you can do this configuration. And apart from it, now see, this is all about that how sparse mode works, and I configured a static RP this time. See, I will be configuring a sparse mode only. The concept will remain same, but the only thing, RPC information will be propagated dynamically now. See, if you are having like 100 devices in your network, in your subnetwork, then how will it be possible for you guys to move onto all 100 devices and to configure your RP information? And also there is no redundancy. There is no redundancy in a static RPC configuration. If like you are using multiple RPs, and I have already explained it to you in previous class. So today we are going to learn that how to propagate your RPs information dynamically throughout your multicast domain, throughout the network, right? So to propagate your RPs information dynamically, if you want to propagate your RPs information dynamically, then for that purpose, we are having two protocols mainly. One is AutoRP, another one is BSR. AutoRP is a Cisco proprietary protocol, and BSR is a. So first of all, we are going to use AutoRP to propagate your RP's information throughout the multicast domain. I'll be using this AutoRP only to propagate your RP's information, right? Any problem? Fine. So now we are going to use AutoRP to propagate your. See, it will not perform multicast routing. It is all about RPC information, right? I mean, this auto RPE will simply responsible to propagate your RPC information throughout the multicast domain. Rest of the things will remain same. Like you configured your RP on all devices, like this is my RP, this is my RP. That task will be done by auto RP actually. That's it. Now, let's try to learn about auto RP now. So if you talk about the auto RP, very first thing that it was a Cisco proprietary protocol. The second thing about auto RP is that there will be two things. Whenever you will configure auto RP in your network, you will always configure two different things. One, mapping agent. In short, you can call it MA. Second, candidate RP. In short, you can call it. So in auto RP, there will be a requirement of configuring these two components, mapping agent and candidate RP. Right? So basically, candidate RPs will be those routers to whom you will announce as a candidate RP. I mean, you wanna configure them as a RP. So might be possible that you are configuring multiple devices as a RP. So all of them will become candidate RP by default, but out from all candidate RPs, there will be only one RP that will be elected by your mapping agent. Basically, all candidate RPs will provide their own information to mapping agent. And then finally, mapping agent will decide that who will be your RP, who will be winner. So basically, candidate RPs will be responsible to generate RP announce messages. What? RP announce messages. Right? And if you talk about the mapping agent, it will also be responsible to generate some messages, and those messages will be known as RP discovery messages. Right? So remember that RP discovery messages will be generated by mapping agent, and RP announce messages will be generated by candidate RP. Fine. Now remember that whenever candidate RP will generate RP announce messages, these messages will also be multicasted, and auto RP will use different multicast address as opposed to PIM multicast address, because PIM was using .13, but auto RP is a separate protocol. However, its work is simple, just to propagate RP's information automatically, right? That's it. But auto RP will be using a different multicast address to propagate its messages. Like RP announce messages will be generated by candidate RP with using multicast address 224.0.1.39. RP announce messages will be forwarded by candidate RPs with using multicast address 224.0.1.39. Now remember, if any message is forwarded with using this multicast address, only mapping agent can listen that. Only mapping agent, not any other device. Only mapping agent can listen for this group address 224.0.1.39. Only mapping agent. Others cannot understand those messages, right? And because if you are having multiple candidate RPs, then mapping agent will be responsible to elect anyone out of them. You can configure multiple devices as a candidate RP for redundancy purpose. Let's say that if any one of the RP goes down, then another one will be elected as RP, right? So for redundancy purpose, you can configure multiple candidate RPs simultaneously. So if you are having, multiple candidate RP, how will it be possible for mapping agent to elect any one RP out from them? Higher RP address. There is no other criteria to use RP to use for RP election. So mapping agent will check RP addresses of all candidate RPs. A candidate RP with the higher RP address will be winner and will become RP, rendezvous point. Previously it was candidate RP, now it's not candidate RP, now it has become RP. And then mapping agent will start to propagate that elected RP's information throughout the network. Now mapping agent will be responsible to propagate that RP's information, that elected RP's information throughout the network, and it will multicast. It will multicast that RP information with using RP discovery messages. And this time it will use multicast address 224.0.1.40.
Mapping agent will be one device.
You can configure multiple devices as mapping agent, but there is no election for mapping agent. If you have configured multiple mapping agent in AutoRP, then all of them will work simultaneously.
Both will propagate.
And I hope now you people have understood that why this entry is always there on all Cisco devices. Because everybody has to listen for this group by default. Because mapping agent will announce, will propagate these messages with using this multicast address. So all of them must listen. I mean, all routers, all devices must listen, must receive messages for this group address. That is why all of them are the member of this group address. And that is why this star comma G entry is available in all routers M route table. Yes, of course, it would be in dense mode as well.
So I cannot.
The point is, now it's a bit confusing. Still, there is no RP, right? Devices do not have RP's information, but they have to propagate your RP discovery messages as well as RP announce messages. How will it be possible for devices to propagate these messages from one device to another, another to another, another? I mean, multicast, how will it be possible to perform multicast routing even without having rendezvous point? See, in sparse mode, you can perform multicast routing after having rendezvous point only. If there is no rendezvous point, then of course you cannot configure multicast routing, cannot perform multicast routing without that. So see, AutoRP is performing multicast routing. AutoRP is generating some messages, and these messages must go from one to another device, another to another device, another. I mean, these messages have to be propagated throughout the multicast domain. How is it going to be possible now, even without having RP? That is why it is mandatory to use the combination of sparse and dense mode. That is why it is mandatory to use the combination of sparse and dense mode if you are going to configure AutoRP in your network. Otherwise, it won't work. AutoRP will not work if dense mode is not there. So dense mode will be mandatory for AutoRP. And it is not all about your PIM sparse mode or PIM dense mode that entry was existing in mRoute table. You know why? Because by default, all routers will listen for that group. That is why that *G entry was there, whether it is in dense mode or it is your sparse mode. Doesn't matter. Because all devices have to be member of this group by default. So that in case in future, if you configure AutoRP, so all devices can listen those messages.
Well,
in this mode,
we do not configure the MAC
agent. Of course, never.
Who generates these messages, which create
this *G? Yes. The problem is, see, by default, your devices are the member of this group, especially 224.0.1.4, only for this group, right? Now, whether you are running dense mode or sparse mode, doesn't matter. Because your devices knows very well that they are having group member for this group address, so they will create a *G entry in their mRoute table. Right? So basically, even if you are using only and only sparse mode, your AutoRP is not going to do work. And we will prove it that in sparse mode, AutoRP will not work. So in AutoRP, you will require to do configure two things. One, mapping agent. Another one is what?
Candidate
RP. Now, it is also possible to configure a common device as mapping agent as well as candidate RP. You can configure a common device as a mapping agent as well as a candidate RP. So both of them can be same device. This is going to be now my mapping agent as well as candidate RP. Move on to R2 now. Now see, I'll configure first of all mapping agent or candidate RP, what do you want? To configure mapping agent, this will be your command IP PIM send RP discovery. So discovery messages will be generated by mapping agent. It means that this device will become mapping agent. And then you see, you have to call your interface on which sparse mode must be enabled. I mean PIM must be enabled, loopback one. And then scope is kind of TTL, like it whenever it will generate discovery messages, it must have TTL value. And this is for security reasons. You know why? Let's say, of course, you have to transmit your discovery messages all around the multicast domain. I mean, this discovery message must be delivered onto all devices in your multicast domain. Now your scope means TTL. Hey, the meaning by scope over here is what? TTL. So this scope value will be depending on that the maximum number of hops in between this device, this mapping agent, and all other devices. And devices, right? So let's say that you are required to cross maximum 5 hops to deliver your discovery messages onto all devices in your multicast domain, right? So generally what do we say, that whenever we are planning to configure mapping agent and RP, it makes sure that they should be a central. I mean they must be configured in the central of your in the center of the network, right? In the center of the multicast domain. So set RP discovery loopback one scope what? 5. So you have configured now mapping agent, and then to configure candidate RP, command will be IP PIM send RP announce message loopback one, and once again scope is what? However, in it is not required to configure 5 because we are configuring the same device as a. It's not it. Same device is mapping agent. So basically, whenever you will define scope for candidate RP, it will be depending on the total number of hops value in between candidate RP and mapping agent, because candidate RPs will be responsible to deliver their messages onto mapping agent only. So basically here scope will be depending on total number of hops available in between candidate RP and mapping agent. Fine. Any problem? Okay. So now you see. Show IP PIM RP mapping. What is it saying? This system is an RP as well as it is also configured as mapping agent. Understood? Great. And you see, okay, static is also configured onto all devices, so I have to remove that first. From R1. However, you see, show IP PIM RP mapping, it will start to prefer that RP which is coming via auto RP over statically configured. Remember that it prefers that RP which was learned dynamically over statically configured. If you wanna preferred your statically configured RP over dynamically learned RP, then you have to configure this command IP PIM RP address, and this is what 333, and then say what override. This is a command what override. So it will override that RP which learned dynamically. Otherwise, by default, your devices will prefer dynamically learned RPs only over statically configured. Fine, but I want to remove it this time. So say no and do show history. Let's configure this command on old devices. Right, guys. Now all devices must have this RPs information dynamically in their database. So let's start it from R1. R2 is configured as mapping agent as well as candidate RP, right? Show IP PIM RP mapping. Check it out. So yes, it is. Now remember that candidate RP will always generate RP announce messages in every 60 seconds by default. And mapping agent will also generate RP discovery messages in every 60 seconds. Even you can prove that. Like we can move on to R1 and we can say debug IP PIM auto RP. So you will start to see your auto RP messages now. So IP PIM RP mapping. So actually its hold down time or expire interval is what? 3 minutes. 3 times to your message interval. And R1 must receive RP discovery messages from mapping agent, right? That okay, this is your RP in every 60 seconds. See, right? 222 is RP, and information is also given by 222, which means that mapping agent and RP, both of them are same, because you can see info source means mapping agent, because mapping agent will be responsible to generate discovery messages, right? So next discovery message will be received by this device after 60 seconds. I hope you can see that. However, it will see after 58 seconds, but proc 60 seconds, right? So it has proved. Exactly. So now you can see show IP, I'm route. Everything is fine over here, but the problem now, let's move on R3 as well and show IP PIM RP mapping. Does it have any problem? No, it have also got this information. Then finally move on to R4 as well. Say show IP PIM RP. Does it have any RP's information over here? No. You know why? Dense mode is not there. Dense mode is not there. Without dense mode, it is not possible to route your multicast packets generated by AutoRP. Of course, on-to-on directly connected devices, it can forward those messages, same as EICRP and OSPF do, even without enabling multicast routing. But the problem is, see, R2 is giving them to R1 as well as R3, but R1 and R3, they are not forwarding those messages towards R4. Reason? Because there is no RP for those groups. There is no RP for those two groups. So how will it be possible? See, onto R4 as well, there is no RP, and without having an RP, it is not possible to route any multicast packet. So that is why I said that it will be mandatory for you guys to enable dense mode for those messages which will be generated by AutoRP. So now on to R4 you cannot get anything. So it is mandatory to use combination of dense mode, sparse and dense mode, and you can enable combination of sparse and dense mode in this way. See, interface serial 1/0 to R1. This is your R1, right? And you can say IP PIM sparse dense mode. 1/1 sparse dense mode, do show history, copy and paste onto all devices. So this time, in place of only and only sparse mode, I have started to use combination of sparse and dense mode. Right, after it, do one thing, move on to all devices and once say clear IPM route start show history and just do it on to all devices now. And even I can show you on to R4 show IP PIM interfaces, that right now you are using the combination of sparse and dense mode. And see show IP M route. Show IP PIM RP mapping. Check it out. Have not it received RP's information now? Right? But now there is a big problem. See, RPA's information is present now on two old devices, right? Automatically. Even you can try to communicate from there, like from here, you can try to ping with it, and it was having a group member. So, see, everything is fine. No problem at all. Fine. After it, let's perform RP lecture. So, what will I do? I'll configure this R2 as mapping agent only, but I'll configure this R1 as a candidate RP and this R3 as candidate RP. So let's move on to R2, do so is to A, and I'll remove this command RP announce. I removed it, right? And then do show history, and then do one thing, configure same commands onto R3, interface loopback 1 IPP miss parse mode should be enabled. Before doing that, let's see RP announce message, RP announce, right? In same manner, I'll do configuration onto R1. Fine guys, now if you move on to R2, do one thing, clear IPPM RP mapping and show history. Just configure this command onto all devices so that all of them can clear their RP's information. Right, now move on R4 once again, show IP, sorry, first of all move on to R2 and then say show IP PIM RP, show IP PIM RP mapping. It is saying that the system is an RP mapping agent. Still it have not received any message. See, this time it have received via from 3, but still it have not received anything from 1. See, now it have received from 3 as well as 1, and 3 is elected via auto RP. 2 is, 1 is not elected because 3 is having higher RP address. Yes. So higher RP address will always be elected. So now this mapping agent will spread this information towards all other, like show IP PIM, sorry, show IP PIM . So remember that mapping agent will always be responsible to advertise only and only elected RP's information, not all RP's information. So first of all, mapping agent will perform election, and then it will propagate elected RP's information throughout the multicast domain. Even you can move on to R4 as well, and on to R4 also you can say show IPP RP mapping. It is 333. However, information source is what? 2222, which is working as a mapping agent. Have you understood it or not? Now there is a small problem for mapping agent. This is for security reasons now. Anyone can become candidate RP. Any router can become candidate RP. Hello? Any one router can become candidate RP. How to protect your mapping agent from unknown candidate RPs? If I do not want to let anyone to become RP in the network, then how can we achieve that? So for that purpose, again, we can configure one security thing, I mean one security policy onto mapping agent itself, which is R2. For that purpose, what can we say? We can say IP PIM RP announce filter, because you know very well that RP announce messages will be generated by candidate RPs, and then you can say group list or RP list. In RP list, you can create a standard ACR, and in RP list, you will specify that how many RPs are there and which they are. So if announce messages are coming from these RPs only, from these candidate RPs, then it will accept them. If RP announce messages are coming from any different host, then your mapping agent will drop those RP announce messages coming from that candidate RP. Have you understood it or not? So this is one another security feature of multicasting, or you can say this is the security feature of mapping agent. Understood? Then after it, now see, because RP is 333, so all of them, all devices having this information that okay, RP is 33333. So whenever they will require to register themselves, they will register themselves onto 3333 only, right? Whenever any source will want to join a group, then it will also send that request towards 33333 only, right? So that's the thing now. And then after it, see, I have explained it to you that how this is working over here, right? This auto RP. Then after it, there is a problem. Problem is, in case if RP goes down, then whole traffic will fall back onto dense mode, because dense mode is also running. In case if RP's information goes down, it means that your sparse mode will be down. Right now, what will happen? See, if you are running dense mode as well as sparse mode, then by default your devices will prefer sparse mode. But the problem is, in case sparse mode stops for doing function, if your sparse mode stops doing function, then what will happen? Whole traffic will fall back onto dense mode, and dense mode is not a reliable technology, right? So what will we do to solve this problem? We can configure this command ippim dm fallback and negative. By default this command is enabled so that in case if sparse mode is down, then your traffic will fall back onto dense mode. But this time you have disabled this command over here, so you can say now do show history, and then I just configure this command onto all devices. So except those two groups, now PIM will never fall back from sparse to dense mode, except those two groups, 1.39 and 1.40, this one used by auto RP. Right, let's continue it once again. So we have gone through it now, we have gone through this auto RP, and we saw that mapping agent performed RP election, and candidate RP with higher RP address won this election, and then mapping agent is propagating only elected RP's information throughout the network, right? And we have seen that without dense mode it was not working. Now the problem is that it can fall back from dense mode, sparse mode to dense mode, right? So for that purpose, to protect our network from such conditions, I have configured this command over here. So remember, now it will never fall back from sparse modes to dense mode. I hope that you people have understood it, right? Apart from it, let's say that someone asked you that you are not allowed to use the combination of sparse and dense mode, right? You are using only and only sparse mode. So once again, I'll configure this sparse mode only onto all devices. Right? Say clear IP and route star. And once again, you will see that R4 will stop to receive any RPC information from mapping agent. As we can see onto R4 now, show IP beam RP mapping. So it will expire. See, after one, see, after 2 minutes, it should have started once again from 2 minutes and 59 seconds. But you see, debug IP beam auto RP. You will see that it will never receive any auto RP message, any RP discovery messages, never ever from mapping agent. Because once again, you have started to use only and only sparse mode. So for those two groups, you are not using dense mode now. So see, you are not receiving anything. After 1 minute and 18 seconds, it will get expired. No. So finally, it will lost RP's information, and it will not be longer having this information that who is RP after expiring this entry, right? So 28 seconds, it will get expired very soon. How to solve it now? So if you are using sparse mode only, then there will be a command in global configuration mode, IPP. Auto RP listener. IP beam auto RP listener. Just use this command on all devices now. If you are using only and only sparse mode, this command force your device to use dense mode only for those two groups, .39 and .40. This command forces your device to use dense mode for those two groups. So once again, you will see that R4 will start to receive RP's information dynamically, right? Because once again, for these two groups, PIM will start to use dense mode. Move on to R4. See, it have received, and say show IP PIM RP mapping. Right? Then after it, I mean, we have now covered all these things, right? Then after it, let's talk about something related to load balancing as well. Because right now, your mapping agent have elected only one candidate RPS RP. So for all groups now, that R3 is what? RP, as you can see onto R4 as well, for all groups. So how can you achieve load balancing now? Let's say that I want to configure RP, this R1 as RP for some of the groups, and this R3 as RP for some of the groups. Let's say from 224.0.0.0 to 231.245.245.245 It should be R1, and you understand? And from 232.0.0.02 239.245.245.245, right? So for these, it should be R3. So yes, you can achieve that. I'll move on R1, and on R1 I'll configure this command now. I'll create one access list one and commit 224.0.0.0, then 7.245.245.245. You understand? And then say, as you configured here this command IP ping. You remember that IP ping send RP announce loopback one is scope 3. Then after it, you can also configure your group list. And group list is what? Standard ACL, in which you have called your ACL, it was 1. So this time it will not announce itself as a candidate RP for all groups. No, it will announce itself as a candidate RP only for those groups which are permitted in your ACL. In same manner, I will move on to R3. I'll create one access list, one permit. First of all, let me check that does it already have an ACL? Yes, no access list. 101. Fine. The access list one permit for 232.0.0.0, then 7.245.245.245, and then configure that command over here as well. Group list is what? 1. So you can also configure your candidate RP for some specific groups only with using group list. So this time this R3 will start to announce itself as a candidate RP only for those groups which are permitted in group list 1. Let's move on to R4. Show IP beam RP mapping. Check it out. This is R1 for this entry. /5, not /4. And this is this. And this entry will definitely expire, right? Don't worry, this entry will definitely expire. First of all, it will expire onto mapping agent, and then after it will stop. To give this information to all other devices, right? So you see show IP PIM RP mapping. So first of all, this entry should get expired. See these two entries. It will get expired after 24 seconds and it will get expired after 1 minute and 12 seconds. This is for this group range. Because both of them were announcing themselves as a candidate RP for this group range, right? For this common group range. So first of all, these entries will expire onto mapping agent, and then it will stop to advertise this information towards all other devices. Then other devices will also expire. I mean, will also remove those entries from their caching. So do one thing. Yes, removed. And now after it, move on to R4. You will see that its timer will also be reduced. See, 1 minute 54 seconds, because it have stopped to receive any message for this entry now. So it will remove it. So for 224.0.0/5, it is 3. Sorry, it is 1. And for 232, it is 3. Is not it? And to prove it, what can we do? I will generate a multicast stream for 232. for 232. Oh, sorry. Yes, it should register itself on 2R3. Show IP number. Yes, S, G entry is there for 232. It's not it. But if I generate multicast system for any other group, like in range of 224 to 231, which means 230.100, right? This entry should not be present, should be present on 2R1, so IPM route. And definitely it should be there. Oh, dot this one, right? But this entry should not be present onto R3. R3. 230.1.10. Is there? Right, so it has proved that now for these group ranges we are having different RPs, but still there is no redundancy. How can you get redundancy now? You will also require to have two more routers. You will also require to have two more candidate RPs, so that you can have one redundant RP for one group list. Like you are have your, you configured R1 as a RP for groups 224.0.0.02, 231.25.25.25, right? So you can also take one another router and then you can configure it as a, tell me, candidate RP. So that you would be having redundant RP as well. But right now there is load balancing, but there is no redundancy. So basically, AutoRP does not provide you redundancy. AutoRP does not provide you redundancy. Sorry, it provides you redundancy, but it does not provide you load balancing by default. It provides you redundancy. Right now we are having, so my God. The problem is, at same time, it can provide you only one thing, either redundancy or load balancing between two candidate RPs. Like previously we were having redundancy, right? But we were not able to perform load balancing. Right now we are able to perform load balancing, right? Because for some of the groups R1 is RP and for some of the groups R3 is RP. But this time there is no redundancy. You know why? Because in case if R1 goes down, will it be possible for R3 to become candidate RP for all other groups? No. Because you already configured an ACL. Piyush, understood? So that's the problem with AutoRP. And one another problem is what? That it's a Cisco proprietary. And one more thing related to AutoRP, if you want to change its timers for mapping agent, let's say that you want that mapping agent should originate messages in every 30 seconds. For that purpose, you can configure this thing. See, when you set RP, send RP discovery messages, scope 5, and then after you can say interval. Like 30. So this time you will start to receive map discovery messages onto all other devices and every 30 seconds. Next packet should be received within 30 seconds now. Proved. Tell me, 56 to 25. which means 30 seconds. Right? Hello? Should I peep him? RP? Nothing. Everything is fine now. So this is that how can you configure auto RP. I also taught you the security, security of your mapping agent. Not scope. Scope was also kind of security, but apart from that, we also learned that how can we configure a secure mapping agent, because in this way anyone can become candidate RP. So I have taught you that how to filter our RP announce messages. So after it, let's talk about BSR. After auto RP, let's talk about BSR. So bootstrap router. Actually, BSR is not a different protocol or different. BSR will not use any different protocol, unlike auto RP. AutoRP was a separate protocol. It was running a separate process onto your device. So it was increasing process CPU overhead as well. But BSR is integrated. It is integrated with PIM version 2 itself. And right now we are using PIM version 2 only. So BSR will not configure a different process, will not run a separate process apart from PIM, because BSR is part of PIM version 2 itself, and PIM was open standard. It means BSR is also going to be open standard. Right, and BSR is stand for bootstrap router. Right now, the question is, the very first thing that I told you, that it is integral with PIM version 2, right? It is built in, so it is not going to use any other multicast address. It will be using that same multicast address used by PIM version 2, which was .13. And if you remember that in PIM sparse mode, I taught you those two different type of messages as well. Do you remember? Bootstrap and candidate RP announce messages. In sparse mode, I taught you 7 types of messages total. Bootstrap. 6th was bootstrap. And 7th was candidate RP announce message. These are the types of messages in PIM sparse mode actually. Fine. Now, as I said, BSR is an open standard. So in BSR, basically you are going to have two major things. One is candidate BSR. Another one is candidate RP. Candidate BSR is same as mapping agent. This candidate BSR is same as mapping agent. But in mapping agent, there was not a candidate mapping agent. If you are configuring multiple mapping agents, then both of them were working simultaneously in auto RP. But in BSR, no, it's not going to be happen like that. You can also configure multiple map BSRs, and then there will be an election between them. First of all, higher priority will be preferred for the election of BSR. First, higher priority. By default, priority is, I think, 0. Yes, it is 0. And then second, it will be higher BSR address. Higher BSR address. Right? ऐसे ही पूछ लो ना यार, क्या बोलोगे इतना? Fine guys. So let me do one thing. First of all, let me remove this auto RP from all devices now. And also I will remove this command as well. Do show. First of all, let me see the configuration of PIM. I'll remove it now. No. Right? Even I don't need it. Same command on to R3 as well. Do show run pipe section IP PIM. There should not be anything. I mean, see, only SPAS mode is configured. I should be configured under interface mode only. Do show run pipe section IP PIM. No. IP PIM, but this command will work whenever you have configured both of them, sparse mode as well as dense mode. So in case if RP gets failed, then it will fall back onto dense mode. Now you can also move on to R4 and you can check this PIM configuration. Do show run pipe section IP PIM. Fine. Now, the point is like how to configure BSR. First of all, I'll configure candidate BSR only. So I'll make it candidate BSR. I'll make it as candidate BSR. Let's do it. To R2, and immediately it will send bootstrap message, and bootstrap messages are the PIM messages, so that they will be multicasted with using 224.0.0.13. So R2 will send that information to R1, R1 will give it to R4 without any problem, and for that purpose you are not required to have dense mode, because it will use the same multicast address used by PIM, because it's a PIM message actually. So see, I'll capture this link now. I'll capture this link as well, right? And sorry, I have to open Wireshark, then I have to open this Wireshark as well. Now I'm going to configure this R2 as a candidate BSR. For configuring your device as a candidate BSR, command will be IP PIM BSR candidate and loopback 1, and then after, you don't need to specify over here anything over here, like you are not having an option of configuring TTR and all like auto RP. We configure TTR value in AutoRP with using scope keyword, but it is not possible to configure it in PSR. Yes. Now, both of them will generate port stop message. You see, PIM using same multicast address, right? You see, is not it? Show 1.5.6.1 IP PIN. Fine. So you can see that by default priority is what? 0. Hold down timer is what? 181 seconds, right? Once it will learn this information. And this is what? Boot start message. And it is having type 4 in your PIM messages, right? Inside the PIM packet. Fine. So we have seen that both of them, I mean on both interfaces, it have sent what? Bootstrap message, right? Just after configuring a router as a candidate BSR. Then after it, you can move on to R1 as well as on to R4, and you can say show IP PIM BSR router. Who is BSR? It's 2. And of course, it should have been elected as BSR. You know why? Because higher BSR address. Priority is common 0. Like you can move on to R2 because I configured it as a candidate BSR. So IP PIM BSR. It will show you that it is a BSR. But who have won this election? Tell me. I mean, you see, this R2 is announcing itself as a BSR. You can move on to R3 as well. So IP PIM. BSR router. Okay, it means that I have not configured this R3 as a candidate BSR yet, right? So do one thing, move on to R3 and then configure the same thing over here as well, like IP PIM BSR candidate loopback 1. Now you will see that there would be two candidate BSRs. Move on to R2 once again and you see that 333, this system is the candidate BSR, but actually this is the BSR, this is your BSR, and we are what? Candidate BSR. Even you can, if you move on to R3, which won the selection, so IP PIM BSR router, you see that this system is the BSR. This is not candidate BSR, right? And that is why if you move on to R1, so IP PIM, see which one? Okay. And once again, its timer would be 60 seconds, right? Periodically, it will generate BSR messages. You see, it's not it.
Let's say debug
IP PIM BSR. To show you that who is the BSR router, right? So I hope that you people have understood that how BSR will propagate its own information. And how will it perform election? You see, right? So it has received bootstrap message, right, guys? And then after it, if you are on a menu plate, let's say that I want to configure my R2 as a BSR. So I can move on to R2 and I can increase its priority. See, what was the default hash mask length value? 0. I will let you know that what is the meaning of hash mask length value in BSR. But for now, you just need to know. Let's see, after loopback, you have to specify hash mask length, which is by default 0. I'll keep it 0. And then after it, we can define its priority. And priority is by default 0. You can make it 1, which is higher than 0. And then after, you can press enter, and you see that your device R2 will become BSR. So if you've been BSR router, what's that? Do. Have you understood it or not? So right now I have configured this R2 as a BSR. Fine, guys. Now I am going to configure this R1 as well as this R3 as candidate RP. However, this R3 is working as candidate BSR2, but I'll configure it as a candidate RPS1. Now, see, whenever you will configure candidate RP in BSR, it will send a unicast message towards BSR. Because they know that who is BSR, bootstrap router. Hey, R1 is having this information that who is BSR. Even R3 is also having this information that who is BSR. So they will send unicast messages towards BSR that we are the candidate RPs. Even I will show you, right? So on to R1, say IP PIM candidate RP candidate actually, and then loop back 1. Right, make sure that sparse mode is enabled over there. So now it has become candidate RP candidate for BSR. Right, move on to R3, and in same manner I'll say IP PIM BSR candidate loop back 1. Check it out that it have sent candidate RP advertisement. Candidate RP advertisement message, and this is what? See, unicast, it is sending it towards 2222 because 222 is what? BSR message. You see, candidate RP advertisement, and you see, for all groups, right? Because we configured this R1 as a candidate RP for all groups. In same manner, I have configured this R3 as a candidate RP for all groups. Previously, BSR, I mean mapping agent, was electing one RP out from all candidate RPs, right? But this time, see, BSR will not be responsible. So IP PIM RP map. BSR will not be responsible. I think I have not configured this command onto R3 yet, right? IP PIM RP candidate loopback 1. Fine. Now you will see that both of them are candidate for RP, right? So previously, mapping agent was responsible to elect any one of the RP and then was propagating that RP information towards all other devices. But this time, BSR will not elect any RP. It will create a RP list. It will create a RP list and will propagate it towards all other devices in bootstrap messages itself. Inside bootstrap messages itself, it will propagate this information that this is your RP list. So all end users will come to know that how many RPs are available in the network. Like if you move on to R4, and then on to R4 you can configure this command, so IP PIM RP mapping. See, it is getting this information from where? See, info source is what? 2222, which is our BSR. So BSR is advertising RP list. BSR is not performing election, RP election, right? Now, if you are using BSR and if you are having multiple candidate RPs, then who will be winner? Low priority will be preferred, and higher RP address will be preferred. First of all, it will compare priority, and then after it will compare RP address. The rest of the things we'll discuss now tomorrow, because thing is, I have to explain that how this, because it's not all about priority and your RP address. There is a formula for BSR which will be used by BSR to calculate hash mask value, and according to that value it will define that which path is going to be, I mean which RP will be elected at. Like right now for all groups it is having two different RPs, right? But any one of them would be elected. Like for example, if you want to see that what will be for IP PIM RP So IP PIM RP hash for what 230.1.10. Let's say that for one, actually not 10, for one. For 230.1.1.1 will be RP. So this is what? Higher RP address, right? See, priority is same, but hash mask length, hash value, see, it is higher. Higher hash value will always prefer. Sorry. Yes, higher hash value will always prefer. So who is having higher hash value? 3. That is why it has won this election, right? Even for all groups, 2, for 3, for 4, if 3 always, 6, for 10, for 15, for 20, it's 3. Every time it is 3. It means by default, BSR will also not perform any load balancing. Why? In which conditions it can perform load balancing, we'll discuss in next class. Right? So try to configure it now. Even you can move on to multicast source and you can stop this one, and then you can once again try to communicate with 230.1.10, and once again you will see that it will start to get replies from there, because RP is working fine. Hello, all are having RP's information dynamically in their database. And remember, this time, because individually routers individually will elect their RP for each group. It does not mean that, let's say that R2 have elect RP as R1 for group 230.1.1.1 and R4 have elect R3 for that same group. No, all and hosts and routers will elect a common RP for all, for that group, because the formula to calculate hash mask value is same, is common onto all devices. What is that formula? How does it perform that? And all these things, all this kind of stuff, we'll discuss now tomorrow.